Good morning. It's good to see everybody here this morning. Would you please stand and let's worship the Lord Jesus Christ. God is good all the time. Amen. Are you washed?
Have you been to Jesus for the cleansing power?
Are you washed
in the blood of the Lamb? Are you truly trusting in His grace? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Well, are you washed in the blood, in the soul cleansing blood of the Lamb? Are your garments spotless? Are they white as snow? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb?
Now let's turn around and greet each other. All right. Good to see you, Janice and Raleigh. Church said amen, and you may be seated.
Good morning. Welcome. We are having evening service this evening at 6 o'clock. We're still in the Baptist Faith and Message on last things, the second coming of Christ to earth. You may not have been here before when I mentioned that we are still taking our evening service offering is for Hope Pregnancy Center. What they mainly do is their main purpose is they do free ultrasounds. And that makes the mothers, I think they said 85% of those that see the ultrasound of their baby choose not to abort it. So it's a wonderful work. We're helping to support that because we believe in that work. So if you want to give and you're not coming on Sunday nights, you want to give toward that, just put it in an envelope and put Hope Pregnancy Center on it, or just Hope on it. And we'll know that that will go toward that work. So be sure to be here at 6 o'clock tonight. And next Sunday, we're going to have a birthday fellowship. We've talked about this. We had one that was for everybody up to August, but this one's going to be for August birthdays. And June added something to that, that you can choose some, if it's your birthday this month, you can choose favorite songs, and you have to give them to us today because we'll be making plans tomorrow. And we'll get to sing those next Sunday nights. And Sally's already ahead of you. She's already given us a list. So if you want to be in on that, give us those lists of your favorite hymns, and we'll sing them next Sunday night. So be sure and be here for that. It's just going to be a little quick fellowship thing, ice cream and cake. So after the evening services. So we want to be sure and participate in that as well. Before that, though, we have Wednesday as our business meeting. So we have a covered dish fellowship at 6:15. Good food, good fellowship. What could you ask more? And then we'll have the business meeting at 7. So if you don't want to come and eat, just come and fellowship. Be here at 6:15 for fellowship, 7 for the business meeting. Okay, we'll have our video.
Hi, kids. Do you have rules at your house? For example, do you have to take off your shoes when you come into the house? Do you have a certain bedtime? Do you have to finish your homework before you play on your computer? What is the most important rule in your house? One day, a man came to Jesus and asked, "What is the greatest commandment?" In other words, what's the most important rule in this universe? And Jesus answered. It's recorded in Mark chapter 12, verse 29. I wrote it down in my notebook so I will not forget it. It says, "Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. Love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind and with all your strength. The second is this, love your neighbor as yourself." Now, it's easy to love those who love us, but it's not so easy to love those who may disagree with you or may not even like you. Jesus goes further and says, "Love your enemies." Now, that takes supernatural power. But this is our call as Christians. Love, 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 love. Christian, this is your call. Love your neighbor as yourself, for God loves all. God loves you, and He wants us to love others too.
Let's pray. Lord, we just love you so much, and we come to you giving you praise and glory for another beautiful day and for all of our many blessings. And dear Lord, this morning, we want to thank you for this offering that we're fixing to receive. Bless this offering and bless those who give it. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Nice. Sweet. Not me. That's not me. That's blaming it on Chris. Sweet.
For our call to prayer today, I want to remind us that our prayers aren't squeaks in heaven, right? You got a squeak going on. It's actually, our prayers are a sweet aroma to heaven. They are described as incense, and our prayers smell good to God in a way. And for our call to prayer today, for the aroma of prayer that should come up from this place, I would like to encourage us and direct us to pray about our marriages. God has called us to be Christians, and if you are married, then our marriages ought to exude the gospel. We ought to have gospel marriages, marriages that speak forth to our children, to our neighbors, to those around us, the gospel. And so let's take a time as the church and in the aroma of prayer that goes up from this place. Let's pray about not just the estate of marriage in general, but let's pray for our marriages. Father, we thank you for the gift of a marriage, for the companionship that you have made and created, and we would ask for your smiles and your blessings upon our marital unions, Lord, that they might shine forth the gospel, and Lord, help us as men to love our wives as you love your church. In Christ's name I pray. Amen.
Amen. Call to prayer. We're going to ask that you would please stand, and we'll read Psalm 16, 7 through 9. Let us read together.
I will bless the Lord who has counseled me. Indeed, my mind instructs me in the night. I have set the Lord continually before me. Because he is at my right hand, I will not be shaken. Therefore, my heart is glad, and my glory rejoices. My flesh also will dwell securely.
Amen, amen. In my heart there rings a melody. Let's make a joyful noise unto the Lord. Sing this morning. I have a song that Jesus gave me. It was sent from heaven above. There never was a sweeter melody. 'Tis a melody of love. In my heart there rings a melody. There rings a melody with heaven's harmony. In my heart there rings a melody. There rings are going to see the King. Hallelujah! Yeah!
Soon and very soon, we are going to see the King. Soon and very soon, we are going to see the King. Hallelujah, hallelujah, we're going to see. No more crying there, no more crying there. We are going to see the King. Well, no more crying there,
we are
going to see the King. No more crying, no more crying there. We are going
to see the King.
Hallelujah.
Song. Amen. Jesus is coming to earth again. What if it were today? Glory, glory. Here we go.
Jesus is coming to earth again. What if it were today? Coming in power and love to reign.
Number two.
Satan's dominion will then be o'er. Oh, that it were today.
Sorrow
and sighing shall be no more. Oh, that it were today.
Then shall the dead
in Christ arise, caught up to meet him in the skies. When shall we
sin to hide, but you have sent him from your side. to walk upon this guilty sod and to become the Lamb of God. Your only Son, no sin to hide, but you have sent him from your side to walk upon this guilty sod and to become the Lamb of God. Oh, Lamb of God, sweet Lamb of God, my love, the holy Lamb of God, oh, wash me in your precious blood and sacrifice the Lamb of God. Your gift of love, they crucified, they crucified, they laughed and scorned him as he, the humble king, the humble king, they named a fraud and sacrificed the Lamb of God. Oh, Lamb of God, sweet Lamb of God, I love the holy Lamb of God. Oh, wash me in your precious blood, my Jesus Christ, the Lamb of God. While Sister LaDonna is playing, let us pray. Father, we thank you. As we meditate upon this song, that you are our Lamb of God, we thank you. Thank you, God, that you sent your Son to die upon the cross, that we may have abundant life. And we praise you today, in Jesus' name, amen. Third verse, I was so lost.
I was so lost, I should have gone.
But you have.
But you have brought me to be led, to be led by your staff and rod, and to be called the Lamb of God. Oh, Lamb of God, sweet Lamb of God, I love the holy Lamb of God. Oh, wash me in your precious blood till I am just a Lamb of God.
Church said amen. And you may be seated. Don't you just love that last song? Oh, Lamb of God, sweet Lamb of God. And I love that last verse. As we were rehearsing this, that last verse, Sister Carol made it very clear to me. Now, that last part of the chorus is, till I am just a Lamb of God. Amen. Amen. Why should I feel discouraged? Why should the shadows come? Why should my heart be lonely and long for heaven and home? When Jesus is my portion, my constant friend is he. Oh, his eye is on the sparrow, and I know he watches me. the sparrow, and I know he watches me. You can sing this right with me. It says, I sing because I'm happy. I sing because I am free. For his eye is on the sparrow. And I know, I'll say it again. And I know he watches over me. Amen.
Isn't it good to be reminded that we are not misplaced in this universe? That he knows us and knows right where we are, and his eye is ever upon us. Well, I hope you have your New Testaments with you today. Our scripture reading today is going to be found in the book of Ephesians, Ephesians chapter 5, and I will read verses 25 down to the end of the chapter. We just kind of had going through a book here, and so our scripture reading has been in a variety of places, and we're in Ephesians 5 today. And if you have it before you, and as I usually ask, if you are willing and able, I would invite you to stand for the public reading of God's holy and inspired word. It is truly a blessing that we have the words of our Creator and Redeemer written before us, inspired by His Holy Spirit, through the mouths and pens of his apostles and prophets. And these are his love letters to us. And so we ought to give careful attention to what he has to say to us. And so let's listen to Ephesians 5, beginning in verse 25. Husbands, love your wives just as Christ also loved the church and gave himself up for her, so that he might sanctify her, having cleansed her by the washing of water with the word, that he might present to himself the church in all her glory, having no spot or wrinkle or any such thing, but that she should be holy and blameless. So husbands ought also to love their own wives as their own bodies. He who loves his own wife loves himself. For no one ever hated his own flesh, but nourishes and cherishes it, just as Christ also does the church, because we are members of his body. For this reason, a man shall leave his father and mother and shall be joined to his wife, and the two shall become one flesh. This mystery is great. But I am speaking with reference to Christ and the church. Nevertheless, each individual among you also is to love his own wife even as himself, and the wife must see to it that she respects her husband. And let's take a time for prayer. Our Father, Lord, we thank you for sustaining us in the week past and for bringing us here to this place on this day. We are reminded that it was upon the first day of the week that your Son, our Savior, conquered our great enemy, death. And we thank you for the secure salvation that he has earned for us and graciously given us. We thank you for the gift of your Spirit that has called us to yourself and put us in a community of believers and has inspired the words that I have just read. And Lord, might they sink down into our ears and into our hearts. And Lord, use them to mold us into a better church. And Lord, into better spouses. And I pray this in Christ's holy name. Amen. And you may be seated. Well, as I'm sure you are probably well aware, we are kind of in the throes and in the midst of a series on the church. I believe this is our fifth message on ecclesiology, just kind of a big fancy word that means the study of the church. And this first part of this series, we've just kind of been answering the question, what is the church? And trying to define the church. So we have a good working definition and a biblical definition of what and who the church is. And our working definition has kind of been summed up in this one sentence, that the church is a group of believers which the Bible describes as a building, as a body, and as a bride. We've started off by looking at the church as being a gathered group of believers. That is what the church is. We are an assembly of called out believers, because the word church literally means the called out ones. God has called his people to himself. We have heard the call of Christ, and we have answered the call of Christ. It is a most holy calling, and by his Spirit and through his grace, we are walking worthy of that calling. We are an assembly of the called ones. In fact, we are a congregation of the called. One person is not the church. It is us all together. We are a congregation of the church, or of the called, which is the church. So the church is a group of believers, of gathered of believers. But the church is also described as a building. When the Bible describes the church, we're a building. It says that Jesus is the builder of the building. In fact, he's the foundation of the building, and we are the structure of the building that he is building, and he is building us into a holy temple. And we are the holy priest within the temple, as well as the structure of the temple, and he is making us into a temple where God dwells by his Spirit, because he promised us in the new covenant that he would be our God and we would be his people and he would tabernacle among us. He would be with us and we would live with him. And so the church is the building where God is. The church is also a body, the scripture says. The body of Christ himself in the mysterious incarnation, where God became flesh. Jesus Christ identifies himself with humanity by taking on our humanity and taking on our flesh. But even more than that, when God becomes man in Christ, he so connected himself to his church that the church is his body. He is the head. And we are the body that is connected to the head. We are in Christ. We are part of Christ. We are the body of Christ. We are connected with each other and connected to Christ. And we complete each other. We complete him and he completes us, because we are the body of Christ. Well, today we've come to our kind of fourth descriptor of the church, and we are going to look at the church being described as a bride. Now, each one of these descriptors that we have gone over so far kind of, you might say, involves a deeper level of intimate love. We are moving deeper and deeper into closeness. into intimacy and into a love. You see, a builder loves his building. Oh, he's been thinking about his building, and he's drawn it out, and he's planned it out, and it's been going through his mind for a long time, and he loves to implement the plans and build his building. He loves his building. And a man loves his body. You see, a man is connected to his body. And he loves his body. He cherishes his body. And he nourishes his body. Because a man has a close connection to his body. But now we have moved to the closest connection of all. Beyond how a builder would love his building, or a man is connected to his own body. But now we come to think about a husband who is intimately bound and becomes one with his wife. This is the most intimate, the most special, the most loving connection that God has created in his order. And in the passage I have just read, the church is Christ's wife. When we think of the church and to define the church, what is the church? The church is the bride of Christ. And so today we are going to consider the church as the bride. The church is Christ's wife. We are going to consider Jesus' love for his bride. This is spoken of often, especially in our text. But we are also going to look at how the bride, or how the church, ought to be with her husband. Because we are the church, he is our husband, and so there is a bride's responsibility, the responsibility of the church, to our husband, who is Christ. And so that's kind of where we're going to go today. And along the way, in thinking about Christ and the church, I think there might be some applications along the way for our own marriages and how we are to be with each other if you are a husband or a wife. And if you're not a husband or wife this morning, then don't fret. This message is still for you, because if you're in the church, you are Christ's bride. And so let us begin today in thinking about Jesus' love for his bride. This here is one of the most amazing thoughts that there could be. In fact, earlier on in this book, Paul prays that we might have power together with all the saints to somehow grasp the length and width and height and depth of the love of Christ, and to somehow know this love that is unknowable. We cannot comprehend it. It is so magnificent. In our text today, we read in Ephesians 5 and verse 25, "Husbands, love your wives as Christ also loved the church and gave himself for her." You see, the Lord Jesus Christ loves his church, and he loves her. He loves us as a man would love his wife, because we are the bride of Christ. And the most elegant of marital love is seen in the relationship between Jesus Christ and his people, who are his bride, his wife. And in fact, it gets extremely intimate. A look down at verse 30-32, he says, "For we are members of his body." We're the body of Christ, and we talked about that last week. But it's even more than that. The next verse, "For this reason a man will leave his father and mother and shall be joined to his wife, and the two will become one flesh. This mystery is great, but I am speaking with reference to Christ and the church. Hear this reference of the marital union and the marital love of the two becoming one. This ultimately is a dramatic picture and presentation of Christ and his church. To where as a man leaves his father to go cleave to his wife, so too the Son of God left the Father, left heaven above, so that he could come down here and be made a man, be made flesh, so that he could be united to his bride, so that he could love her and be so intimate with her because she is his wife. The church is Christ's wife. The church is part of him. In fact, the church completes him. I mentioned the verse last week, just a mind-blowing verse in Ephesians 1, the last two verses, verses 22 and 23, where Christ is given everything to be head over the church, which is his body, the fullness of him who fills all things. The church in some way completes Christ as the God-man, because it is not good for the man to be alone. And when God became man, he came down here not to be alone, but he was meant to be in communion with his woman, with his wife, with his church. This intimate love relationship. And might I say that Jesus' love for his bride is a special kind of love. And it is particularly directed toward his church. And this is something that we ought to revel in as the church. You know that Jesus' love for his church, bear with me on this here, but I do think that Jesus' love for his church often gets diluted for fear that someone might feel excluded from it. And so we kind of want to erase the special relationship that Christ has with his church and somehow equate it with the kind of relationship that just goes on with everybody. But beware of a sappy sentimentalism, because it leads to a universalism that the scripture does not teach. Let me put it another way. We are in a day of great sexual freedom. Polyamory is often mentioned, but Jesus is not polyamorous. Jesus is not polygamous. Jesus' love is not a philandering love given willy-nilly to any old filly. That's not the kind of love that Jesus has. He has a particular, directed, magnanimous love for his wife. Jesus loves his church as a husband should love his wife, with a singular affection. I tell you, and the church ought to revel in this, we ought to rejoice in this, to think about the breadth and height and length and depth of this love that Christ has for us, because we belong to him. We are his bride. We are his wife. There is a special love that comes from him, a particular love. In fact, we are the sole object of his marital affection, because that is what marriage is. And when Christ loves us, guess what? He marries us. In fact, just this last week in my studies, I started looking up the references to God's love and Christ's love in the scripture, and I found that there were 92 references in scripture. I could be off in this, but I found that there were approximately 92 references in scripture of God's love that is directed towards mankind. And out of those 92 references of God's affection, 90 of them, 90 out of the 92 were directed particularly towards his people, specifically towards his church, directly towards believers, on specifically his bride, his church. It's like, oh, what great a love that the Father has lavished upon us that we should be called the children of God. Or Christ says, those that love me, I too will love them, and my Father will love them. Or how the love of God has been shed abroad in our hearts. Or here, that Christ loves the church. 90 out of the 92 times it's directed towards his people. 2 times it is directed towards mankind generally or generically. So when we speak of God's love, if we are going to be biblically balanced, we ought to speak of his love towards us 45 times more than of just his generic care for the creation in general. Because his eye may be upon the sparrow, but we're his bride. And he loves us in a special, special way. And by way of application, let me say this, that if you want to feel the assurance of God's love, if you want to know Christ's embrace, there is only one place where that is felt. There is only one place where that is had, and that is in the church. Because the church is his wife. The church is his bride. Jesus loves his church. We're the bride of Christ and the special objects of his affection. And by the way, let me address us as husbands. Husbands, if your wife does not feel a special kind of love from you that would be different from the kind of affection you might have for anybody else, if she does not feel that, there is something wrong. Because a bride ought to feel this unique affection from her husband. And can I tell you that the church is not just another woman in the world to Christ. He loves us as his bride, as his church. And so this is something that we ought to swim in this, that he loves us because we are his wife. Well, let's move on from Jesus' love for us. And think a little bit about what is our responsibility to Christ as our husband. If the church of Jesus Christ is the bride of Christ and we are his wife, we are his bride, how is it that a bride should be with her husband? Because this instructs us on how we ought to be with Christ and what we ought to be about when the church comes together. And then let me start off with this one. A bride should dress for her husband. A bride does dress for her husband, especially on the wedding day. You think of a wedding dress. In fact, there's a picture of one on our bulletin. A bride will dress to please her husband, for his eyes only. That's the way a bride dresses. And could I say that we as the church, let me just say we should dress for church. I think it is biblical to say we should dress for church. Sometimes we'll say, you know, we ought to put on our Sunday go to meetings. You know, I'll say, I can't wait to get out of the monkey suit, you know, because I don't like putting on my Sunday go to meetings, you know. But we do say that. Now let me qualify this. Because when I say that we ought to dress for church, I am not at all meaning our external adornment. I am not talking about our external clothes. Because the scripture makes no mention. It is not about our clothes, the way we dress for church. It is about our conduct when we come to church. Being dressed for church has nothing to do with the style of clothes we are wearing. Religiosity gets all off into the clothes. But no, we are talking about conduct when we say the way the bride dresses for her husband. In fact, there are warnings in Scripture to wives about undue attention that they may give to their outward dress. 1 Peter 3, verses 3 to 4, that the dress shouldn't just be with outward adornment, the braiding of hair and gold and, you know, and all these things, but it's with the person on the inside in a gentle and quiet spirit. And this is the way a bride should present herself and dress for her husband. And if you want to take me to task on that a little bit, there is a verse. A pastor ought to have a verse if he's going to throw something out there like that. So Revelation chapter 19, Revelation chapter 19, verses 7 and 8. Let us rejoice and be glad and give glory to him, for the marriage of the Lamb has come. The Lamb's getting married. He's gonna meet his bride. The marriage of the Lamb has come, and the bride has made herself ready. Oh, she's getting ready. She is presenting herself to her husband. And then verse 8, and it was given to her to clothe herself with fine linen. Oh, she's got a dress. Bright and clean. But it's not clothes like you think, for the fine linen is the righteous acts of the saints. When we dress for church, when we get ready to come together to meet our husband, we are to be dressed, we are to be adorned with holiness. In the beauty of holiness, the bride of Christ ought to be when she assembles together. We are to be decked out with good deeds, the righteous acts of the saints. That's how we dress to present ourselves to our husbands. And can I say, we are not dressed for church when we attend with sin. When the church comes together and there is sin and we bring sin in, then we are undressed and misdressed. In fact, our misdeeds make us misdressed for church. We don't have on the wedding attire. You know, to come to church fighting and complaining, that's the wrong clothing for church. Can I ask you today, you put on your Sunday go to meetings, but are you dressed right? You know, are you really dressed right for church today? Moaning and groaning is the wrong clothing. Bad attitudes make our dress inappropriate. Immorality makes us immodest to show up in church. Because see, a bride can be badly dressed. And the bride of Christ is to be correctly dressed with the righteous acts of the saints that adore her. And we can show up in our Sunday best, in our Sunday go-to-meetings, and still be severely misdressed for church if we're not dressed right and adorned with holiness. And so the bride should dress for her husband. Something else about the bride. The bride of Christ, or a bride, should listen to her husband. You know, when the bride assembles, when the wife comes to church, we gather together, we come to hear some words from him. In fact, our Lord said, Matthew 8:18, be careful how you listen. You know, as the bride of Christ, we need to listen to Christ, and we need to be careful how we listen to our husband. In fact, I counted 17 different times where our Lord has this little phrase to say in his teaching, "He who has ears to hear, let him hear." In fact, over and over again, repeatedly, he says to the seven churches in the book of the Revelation, "He who has ears to hear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches." Christ is speaking to the churches, and he is speaking through his Spirit and through his words, and he says, "You need to listen to me. He who has ears to hear, let him hear," because a bride should listen to her husband. And the church is a place where the bride gathers together to hear from her husband. It's something we should do when we come together as the church. We get a taste of this in Acts chapter 10. Peter shows up to give a sermon, Acts 10, verse 33. "And so I sent for you immediately, and you have been kind enough to come. And now then, we are all here, present before God, to hear all that you have been commanded by the Lord." They assembled together. They got the man that had the message to hear what the husband had to say to his bride. Do you know what we in the church, as the bride of Christ, you know, aren't we kind of in a long-distance relationship with him right now? I mean, we just are. You might say we're in the engagement period of the relationship. And though we have not seen him, we do love him, that Peter tells us. And you know, we love to hear from him. Oh, how lovers delight to get a love letter from their loved one. And do you know, when we come here, we are the bride of Christ coming to hear the love letters that Christ has given to his church. When the church assembles, we come to give attention to what Christ has said. Our Lord, our husband's word is preeminent to us. It is loved by us. It is paramount to us. When we assemble, we want to hear from our head, because he has something to say to us. Ephesians 5 and verse 26, after it says that Christ loved the church and gave himself for her, that he might sanctify her, having cleansed her by the washing of water by the word. You see, the bride of Christ listens to the word of Christ, because the church, what we are, we're a group that is built into the bride that comes to listen to what our head, what our husband has to say. And oh, our husband's words to us are great. The word of Christ makes us holy. The word of Christ and listening to his words cleanses us and sanctifies us and washes us and renews us and protects us. Because as his bride, as his wife, we listen to what he has to say to us. Psalm 119, listen to how David, his joy to hear God's word. Psalm 119, 103, "How sweet are your words to my taste, yes, sweeter than honey to my mouth. From your precepts I get understanding, therefore I hate every false way. Your word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path." I tell you, we come here to listen to Christ and his words. And you know that a husband's words should be and must be a blessing to his wife. The way Christ speaks to us is a blessing. And the way that a husband would address and speak to his wife ought to be a blessing. It ought to be edifying words that build her up, sanctifying words that encourage her in holiness, encouraging words, cleansing words, healing words, correcting words, protecting words. This is the way a loving husband speaks to his wife. And a wife should listen to the words of her husband. And the church should listen to the words of her husband. Let me again address you that are husbands. How are your words to your wife? What you say to her, are they like Christ's words that he says to his bride? How do you speak to your wife? So a bride should listen to her husband, but a husband should speak blessing to his wife. Another responsibility of a wife and the church who is the wife of Christ is that a bride should praise her husband. Do you know that praise is a priority for a bride? The praise of the husband is a priority for the bride. When the church gathers, when the bride of Christ comes and assembles together, we come together to garner praise for one person. That is our God. We come to garner praise for him, and we direct praise to him. That's why part of our church services are given over to praise. Because when the bride comes together, a bride praises her husband. It's what a good bride does. In fact, I go back a little earlier, Ephesians chapter 5, verse 19 and 20. Speaking to one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing and making melody in your hearts to the Lord, always giving thanks for all things in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ to God, even the Father. This is what we do and why we have a singing service. Because this is what a bride does. She sings her husband's praises. Colossians chapter 3 and verse 16, let the word of Christ dwell in you richly as you admonish one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing and making melody in your hearts and giving thanksgiving, because that's what a bride does. A bride praises her husband. Another Hebrews chapter 2, a short little verse, but to the point of what I'm trying to make here, Hebrews chapter 2 and verse number 12, saying, I will proclaim your name to my brethren, and in the midst of the congregation, I will sing your praise. I will proclaim your name. We sing the name of Jesus, and we'll proclaim it in the congregation when we all gather together, and we're going to praise that name because a bride praises her husband. You know, a bride should speak well of her husband. It's how a wife should speak of the one she is married to. She should speak well of her husband to her own self internally. She should be thinking good thoughts about him. And just, you know, her mind should be full of praises about who she is married to. But not only in her own mind, but also she speaks well of her husband externally to others. You know, a good bride does not complain to others about her husband. It's not what a bride does or what a bride should do. A bride praises her husband. Do you know that a bride spreads good news about her husband? You know what the church does? We gather together, we sing his praises, we love to talk about Jesus, and we go out, and what do? We talk about Jesus, we spread good news about our husband, about the one that loved us, and redeemed us, and cares for us, and provides for us. We spread good news about him, because you know when you love someone, you speak well of them to everyone. And a bride praises her husband. And so when the church, when the bride, when we gather together as his body, one of the main reasons we do so to praise our husband. We get together and we like to talk about him. We like to think about him. We like to sing about him. We are thankful for him. We tell other people about him. because a bride praises her husband. Another responsibility of the bride of Christ, or brides in general, is a bride should believe in her husband. A bride dresses for her husband, and she listens to her husband. A bride praises her husband, but a bride believes in her husband. You know what one of the main monikers of the church, one of the main descriptors when we think of believers, of the redeemed, is the word believers. That's how we are described. The bride of Christ is a group of believers. We believe some things. I mean, the main descriptor of us is that we believe in our husband. We believe in the Lord Jesus Christ. We believe in his person. We believe in his work. And we believe in his word. That a good wife believes in her husband, in his person, in his work, and in his word. Because, you know, the bride, believes in who he is. We believe in who Jesus is, in himself, who he is as a person. We believe that he is the Son of the living God, that he is our creator and redeemer and sustainer. We believe that he is the God-man in his person, divine and human. We believe he is our sustainer, our savior. We believe in who he is in his person. The bride believes in who he is. And you know, a bride ought to believe in who her husband is and who he is as a man. A bride not only believes in who he is, but a bride believes in what he does. As the church, the bride of Christ, we believe in the work of the Lord Jesus Christ. We believe in the work that he set himself out to do. He came from heaven. He left his father. He came down here to work and to labor for us, to work for us, to live for us, to earn for us. He works for us, and we believe in what he did. We believe in his endeavors that he set himself to do on behalf of his bride, that he came down here to work and to sacrifice for us. And we believe in that. I believe in who he is, and I believe in what he does in his endeavors. And you know, a good bride believes in what her husband does. She believes in his work. But the bride also believes in what he says. The bride of Christ believes in the words of Christ. He has communicated to us, given us his love letters, and we believe what he says. We believe who he is. We believe what he does. And we believe what he says. A bride believes in her husband. And can I say that a bride should believe in her husband, in who he is, in what he does, and in what he says? Well, in all of this, am I speaking about our marriages? Or am I speaking about the relationship between Christ and the church? Which one? Yes, I am. It's both of them. Because you see, God, from the very beginning, when he made man, and he put him in the garden to do a work, and then he said, it's not good for that man to be alone. and he fashioned someone special for that man so that these two could become one. And that marriage is a picture of the gospel from the very, very beginning. And all marriage is a picture of the gospel. And God forgive us, we have corrupted the gospel so much by the testimonies of our marriage. But you know that every aspect of our marriage, even our marital unions, should sing forth the gospel of Christ's love for his church. And do you know that we are to model the gospel in our marriages as husbands and wives? We look to the relationship between Christ and the church. He's the husband, the church is his wife and bride. We look to that as a model for how we are to be in our own marriages. That as a husband is to show sacrificial love toward his wife. He is to give her wonderful words of life as he speaks to her. He is to protect her and to provide for her. He is to be the savior of his body, and she is his body. And a wife looks to the church as she submits to her husband. She dresses for her husband. She listens to her husband. She praises her husband. And oh, she believes in her husband. So yeah, I'm talking a bit of both today. Because I'm going to be willing to bet we need a bit of both. I think as the church of the Lord Jesus Christ, we need to be reminded that we are the bride of Christ. We ought to revel in his special love for us, but also be reminded of our responsibility to him as his wife. And then us in our individual relationships, we're to say, wow, you know, I'm a Christian husband, I'm a Christian wife, and my relationship is to reflect this. What we do every week when we come dressed for church, right? And we come to listen, and we come to praise, and we come to believe. You know, this is how we're to be with Christ, and this is how wives are to be with their husbands. Well, let's stand for a concluding. I think we do have a hymn about singing our Savior's praise.
I will sing the wondrous story of the Christ who died for me. How he left his home in glory for the cross of Calvary. Yes, I'll sing the wondrous story of the Christ who died for me. Sing it with thanks and glory gathered by the crystal sea.
Well, I hope you were challenged today and encouraged as the bride of Christ and also in your own relationships at home. I do want to remind you, you can come back and be encouraged tonight. We'll meet again at 6 o'clock. Lord willing, have a good discussion. Again, thinking about our Lord's return and his judgment of both the righteous and the wicked, both believers and unbelievers. And so if you want to come to that discussion, please join us. And I will leave us with the word of benediction. May the love of God, the fellowship of the Spirit, and the salvation of the Savior be with you now and forevermore. Amen and amen.